Hi class, how's it going? So right about now you should be working on your quizzes 1, 2, and 3 due tonight before midnight. And basically I will show you what I've already done. First, let's listen to a little music. Set the tone. It's electronic, but it's still good. Okay, so if you want to go to modules, chapter 3, right here, I've already given you 2 trailers that will relate to your reading. Just fun stuff. You don't have to do it, but if you want to, if you're a movie watcher like me, there's one called The Razor's Edge. It's about it's a movie written based upon a book called The Razor's Edge, written by Somerset Maugham. And it's pretty philosophical. It's about a guy, and Bill Murray plays the character. Bill Murray's the actor, real famous actor. You'll love him. It's a little bit of an older movie, but he plays a guy that's super rich and has a lot of money. He has everything. And he's searching for the meaning of life, you know, like what is the good life kind of thing. And the movie's all about that. And he ends up with the going into India, studying with some, you know, great philosophers. And you'll see what he does. But long story short, he ends up giving all his money and riches away. He doesn't care. And he's super happy. It's a really cool book. And a pretty good movie based upon the book. Upanishads, yeah, that's who he studies with in India. And I believe he studies with other people too, but the movie's really cool. And then there's another movie, Kundun, and this is by Martin Scorsese, who's one of my favorite directors. Pretty awesome. This is about Buddhism, China. You know, there's a few themes running through it: reincarnation, karma, the concept of justice, and yeah, it's fascinating. If you were to think about, well, if reincarnation is true, how could you possibly verify it with somebody living now, you know? And in this movie, it shows you a scene where it kind of brings that to life. It's pretty interesting. But anyways, 2 cool movies. You don't have to watch them, but if you want to, they'll relate to this reading. And yes, so yeah, once again, tonight you have 3 quizzes due: chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3. I start them off on Monday. They're all due Thursday nights. So, so let me go over some of the things that I think are important. And once again, this is a rich chapter. We can't possibly discuss everything in here. You could spend a few weeks on this. Some people spend a whole semester on it, but just say a few weeks. If you were to take a world religions class, a week or like, you know, 1 lecture, maybe even 2, could be rushed because there's a lot of rich concepts going on, but we'll start. So yeah, here's a main theme again. Appearance and reality. What you think is the case might not be the case. You know, even relating down to what you are as a person and the concept of self, and they get into that here. But anyways, so we find Indian myths recorded in an ancient set of religious hymns known as Vedas. The Vedas lay the foundation for Indian religion and philosophy. So now you're finally going to see a religious emphasis come in to a philosophical emphasis. So you're going to think of 2 circles joined together, and inside the intersection of those 2 circles coming together, you're going to have philosophy and religion intersecting on, you know, asking these questions about reality and the good life and who you are and what's out there. But let's see. So you might say this was going on during the time of the Greeks. They just weren't communicating with each other, but they were still thinking about reality. So let's go down here. Let me see what I have for my notes in this section. Oh, yeah, right here. But so was everything else. Everything but was a manifestation of God. God was everything. Now, right here, this is you might read through that quickly and not know what's going on. They're making a claim that everything is God, and that God is everything. Well, what in the world does that mean? Well, it just so happens there's a philosophical view called pantheism, a doctrine which identifies God with the universe, or regards the universe as a manifestation of God. So this is interesting now. So when you look around reality, an Indian philosopher might say, look, reality itself is literally God. It's an extension or a manifestation of God. It's not exactly clear on what they mean by that, but that's the claim going on right here. Is an idea that appears in many traditions around the world. In the Indian tradition, this is an all-encompassing deity, eventually comes to be called Brahman. So you might say, like, you know, one of these claims, like, when you die, you're like a drop of water that gets brought back into the big sea where it came from, you know, where you started from, and that sea is God itself, you know, and you go back to God. So when something like that comes about, you might say, well, what makes me different from the things that I see in reality and different from God? In other words, what individuates me, Joseph, from you, or from the desk that I'm working on and the chair that I'm sitting in and the ocean that I'm looking at? What is it? If everything's God and God is everything, like, is the chair God? Is the desk God? Am I God? Am I a part of God? When you don't give me clear distinctions on what you mean by that, it's kind of blurry. So, but you might just say, there's something going on. Go back up to the beginning. Right away, there's something going on about appearance versus reality. I appear to be distinct from reality, meaning I have a conscious life. I can think about things. I can close my eyes and imagine stuff. And that seems different from the microphone I'm using now, the desk I'm sitting at, the sea that I want to, or the ocean that I want to go be by, or the car that I have in the parking lot. But you might say, those are appearances that I might be perceiving, but in reality, those things are just an extension of God, and I'm an extension of God. And yeah, so we'll just leave it at that. You can hash that out on your own. But again, this book that we're using is called The Great Conversation. The class is ancient philosophy, you know, through medieval. But what's really going on is we're trying to think more deeply about reality. We have a love of wisdom, meaning we have an awe about reality. We'll want to know more. And this is something I didn't mention in the previous lectures. Why does this matter? Here's a good reason why. And this is very practical. The more you know about yourself and the society in which you live, the better a citizen you can become and the more you can contribute in a healthy way. So I can repeat that. The more you know about yourself and reality or the society in which you live, the better, not just a personnel, but a better functioning citizen, meaning you can contribute to the community, to the society around you, and make it more meaningful. So you might say the business of philosophy, or, you know, analyzing reality like that, is to be able to contribute right back to it. And so that's the practical application. So let's see here. Unlike Greek philosophy, then, Indian philosophy arises not from the rejection of a myth. And what do they mean by that? Going back to Hesiod and Homer, talking about the gods and people, but an attempt to, you know, extend or explain or rationalize it. And that's what they're doing with this claim so far, the Indian philosophers. And it gets into pantheism. That's the philosophical definition for, you know, all is God, God is all. But let's go. Yeah. And in the Upanishads, and once again, if you want to see that movie on the Razor's Edge, you can see it's really cool. But it's about a guy who, you know, gives up his riches, explores the world searching for meaning, hangs out with the Upanishads. And he's thinking just like the Greeks are. You know, they're having a conversation, but not with one another, but they're thinking about reality as a whole. And they're asking questions like, what is the world? Where does it all come from? What are we? How do we relate to the world? So unlike the Greek philosophers, however, the anonymous authors of the Upanishads did not reject the older myths, which by this time contain sophisticated ideas about the nature of reality. Instead, they built on those ideas and worked to fashion them into a rational, coherent doctrine. So yeah, you might say they're going to press the religious aspect more now and think about reality philosophically. So they're using religion. But it's in one sense, you might say, well, something seems kind of vague, like God is all and all is God. Well, what does that mean for me? But in another sense, it's not vague. They're trying to draw distinctions that are better than what we saw in chapter one. Unlike Greek philosophy, then Indian philosophy arises not from a rejection of myth, but an attempt to extend, explain, or rationalize it. Okay, so we already covered that. Highlighted this for a reason. Oh yeah, just as your eyes sees but cannot see itself, the self cannot perceive itself because it is the thing that does the perceiving. So we cannot say that it has any particular characteristics. We can, however, say what it is not, namely, it is not bodily or mortal or subject to fear or injury. It's beyond all that. So let's see here. Yeah, karma. The idea that one's actions in this life can affect the circumstances of one's next life, as the doctrine of karma. So this starts to make sense now of like, well, what's the good life and how do we go about living it and why does it even matter? Well, one of the reasons why is because the actions that you do in this world affect other people and yourselves. And according to this doctrine, you could be born into another human body, an animal, a leaf, or whatever. And you might, if you do bad things in this life, think of Hitler. Maybe you're born into a really lower state in the next life. So now, again, philosophically, they're starting to think about it coherently and to form a doctrine. And in many ways, then, the appearance of many turns out to be an illusion. There's only one. What does that mean? Again, what does the many mean? Me, you, the desk, the microphone, all these things seems like many things going around. There's all kinds of stuff going on. But the claim being made now is it's all one. And I leave that for you to figure out. Yes, okay, so now we're into Buddhism, Buddha, 5th century BC. Again, there's a movie on your module by Kundun, gives you the perspective of the Dalai Lama, the 14th reincarnated Dalai Lama, and how Buddhism is lived out through him. It's a pretty fascinating movie. Whether you accept Buddhism or not, it's really worth a watch because it puts things in perspective. So now think about chapter one and how we were talking about the gods, and we mentioned a couple of virtues like moderation, justice, things like that, trying to avoid the vice of being arrogance called hubris. Now we're getting into more specific, even more practical things, and not only like, what's the good life? But here's a way on how to live a good life. And the Four Noble Truths kind of unpack this. They're going to make claims about reality. Again, there is suffering. There's the origination of suffering. It comes from somewhere. There's a cessation of suffering, meaning it could go away. And there's a path to the succession of suffering, meaning there's a way to get to the point where suffering goes away. And I'll stop right here. I'm going to give you a really good tension point. There's another religious worldview, theism, but more specifically Christianity. And you'll love this part if you haven't read this. Go to 1 Peter 4 and see how it contrasts with this Four Noble Truths of Enlightenment as far as Buddhism. It's a tension point because remember, this is a philosophical conversation. And there's many great ideas we're going to investigate. One of them is, what's the good life? How do we get there? All right, Buddhism is trying to tell us. Good life is to avoid suffering. You want to get rid of it because it's everywhere. 1 Peter chapter 4 in the New Testament. You're going to love this part. I want you to read on your own. God promises suffering and says it's good. What? What? All right. So that's the tension point. You have one world religion saying suffering is good and it shouldn't go away because it's good for you. I'll give you a little hint. The claim there is being made that suffering, sorry, true love can only come about through suffering. And therefore, God uses suffering to mold moral virtue inside of you to make you a better person. Whereas the Four Noble Truths and the Enlightenment with Buddhism is to say, no, best thing to do is avoid suffering altogether. So that's a good tension point between two worldviews and religion, and I'll let you investigate that on your own. Because remember, another part about this class is what you think, not what I think. I'm just going to throw some ideas and tension points and some clarity out there for you, and I'm going to let you, you know, jump in and tell me what you think. And it doesn't mean that you have to be 100% decided on an issue. You can change your mind as days, weeks, months, years go by, even outside of this class. The important thing is to at least think about these things more seriously. And that's what philosophy is all about. And why? Why would we even do this? Because they matter. I mean, when you think about what the good life is and how do we get there, man, that seems like a powerful idea, doesn't it? Okay. Suffering, and the word for that is dukkha. And by the way, if I pronounce any of these Indian words, I am totally sorry, or even the Greek words. And let me just weigh in on that. I took a Greek class in my PhD program, and I literally translated the Credo, which you're going to read for Socrates. So I translated it in Greek. There's debate on how to pronounce certain Greek words that nobody knows, because Greek, the Attic Greek that was used for a lot of these translations, it's a dead language. So go back to the last chapter when we looked at logos. It could be logos. Logos or logos. Well, which is it, Joseph? I don't know. So I use that appeal to ignorance right there, and I'll just map it onto this. Is it dukkha or dukkha? I don't know. And if you really wanted to study this more, you can. And keep in mind, your first paper, you're supposed to think about something you totally disagree with and argue against it. So it could be that some of you are already forming your arguments against chapter 1, chapter 2, or even now chapter 3. Okay, at a superficial level, the cause of suffering is craving or attachment. Oh, this is interesting. And I put it in a note here. You know, a lot of us have suffered in relationships. And one of the reasons why is we have possessiveness over somebody else. When we say, that's my man, or that's my woman, or that's my, you know, that's my person, I'm in a relationship with him. There seems to be some sort of possessiveness that's being used. And it's kind of interesting on, what is it, near book, it should be page 39. When we talk about attachment, it seems like maybe we suffer because we shouldn't be possessive over other people. And that's a form of attachment. Very interesting. How many of us are attached to inanimate objects that matter to us, like online video gaming or relationships? And you think that somebody is yours, right? And they never were yours in the first place. And so when they leave, you're devastated. You're like, oh my gosh, we were in love. We had so much in common. But maybe they never felt the same way. So anyways, this is just me thinking about it. Or maybe, you know, you're at a job for 10 years, maybe you have a college major that your parents decided for you, but it's not something you like. It could be there's an unhealthy attachment to something your parents wanted for you that you don't even want. So you break that and you say, no, this is what I'm going to do. So anyways, just think about that word attachment and think about things that you might be attached to that are causing your suffering. And then to break free from those would give you more enlightenment or, you know, a better life. And this is what the Indians and the Buddhists are after, breaking unhealthy attachments. Very interesting. And again, we get more very practical application, the note, Eightfold Path. Right view, right intention, right speech, right conduct, right livelihood, right effort, right mindfulness, right concentration. So these aren't vague things anymore. These are starting to get, you know, like we can imagine. Let's say you get into an argument with somebody and then the argument's over and you feel bad about it. Go back through these 8 things and say, did you have a right view? Did you have right speech? Did you tell somebody to F off or get really mean with them? You can go back and say, crap, I didn't have right speech. I didn't have right conduct. And doing these filters over and over, they mold your character to become better. We'll see later on in a chapter with Aristotle that he's thinking just like these, the Indians here are thinking, as far as how to develop virtue inside of you. It's very fascinating. And they call this the right view. Nirvana. This word here. Equanimity involves a calm, even-handed assessment of things as they are. Very interesting. Without attachment or prejudice. I highlighted that word because it seems very philosophical. You might say that this is a very objective way of seeing things without being personally motivated, as far as emotionally. You get really charged, you're really angry or super happy. How about avoiding both of those and being very neutral? No emotion at all. You just clearly think about something. And that's what this word's getting at. As things are, and you might say that this is a nice word that they're using to become more philosophical in the way they analyze reality. But sometimes it's easier said than done. It's hard to not get emotional about things that are important. So I leave that for you to figure out. This one's very interesting. So yeah, it says if you follow the Eight Noble Path and the Four Noble Truths, you can approach nirvana, and that's breaking the stage of reincarnation. And then down here, it's not exactly clear what that means. Do we exist? Do we not exist? And I have a footnote here that this quote seems a little vague. And it talks about you after you die. And then down here it says, even you might think the authors of this book were pressing, and it says, but when pressed for details, the Buddha rejects both the suggestion that the liberated person exists and the suggestion that here she does not exist. So there's no real clear answer. And you might say that's an in-house debate for Buddhism. You just got to be clear on your terms and what you mean. Do I exist when I die? Do I not exist? If I do exist, do I remember my past life, here on earth as Joseph and my family and all my memories, or do I not have any of those at all? And if I was reincarnated into a monkey or a grasshopper or a leaf, obviously a leaf, I'm not going to have memories, but what about a monkey or a grasshopper? I mean, you got to be clear on that. And it's not clear here that, the readings that are quoting the Buddha are actually clear. So we'll see. There's been debate over this ever since. And what else? Down here on page 41, we'll see what it's talking about aggregates. This is Buddhism now trying to make a claim over categories of reality and what you are as a person. Now, remember, Democritus, we saw the Greek, he thought that everything was made of atoms. So right here, it's going to get more specific. You're going to have atoms, that's a material form, but they're going to have sensations, perceptions, mental activity. So when we talk about a person, it's not just as simple as Democritus talking about atoms. Now we're going to get more distinctions, and I like that. It's getting more deep, more philosophical. There's more contemplation and rational deliberation, meaning they're thinking more deeply about these terms than Democritus was, but they're adding on to what he did. Again, great conversation. You start off with an idea with the ancients, you build on it. It's more robust. What does robust mean? Just it has more properties and attributes that are, it's not simple anymore. It's a little bit more complicated, but at the same time, it's enlightening when you think about it. Because it makes sense. It adds more depth to the conversation when you have more distinctions. Let's go down. And again, I can't cover everything in this chapter. It's totally impossible. I'm just highlighting things that stood out. What else? Nagasena right here in these five aggregates. Fundamental constitutes of reality. This is something interesting. So when you think about what's out there and what's reality made of, different things are going to stand out. And the reason I bring that up is because you can read this section, but the Buddhist is trying to talk about, well, what are categories of reality? If I were to divide category up like it was a pie and I cut it in sections, one section could be consciousness, another perception, another material thing. You're trying to divide reality up into these different components. As we'll see later on, Aristotle tries to do this, and he has 10 categories of reality. One of them is substance. One of them is being. Just fascinating stuff. But this is the start here. So you might say, again, it's not real simple. It's just all atoms from Democritus. There's a lot more going on when we think about what is reality. And I think that's all I want to say. And then the rest of the reading is up to you. Oh, yeah, right over down here. Nayayaka, let me try this. This is not easy for me. Nayayakas, this is bringing in focus on logic and epistemology. Again, these are huge branches of philosophy, metaphysics, simply the Greek word physics, and it's basically talking about nature. But metaphysics is above or beyond nature or above or beyond physics. I'll give you an example. Let's say you're looking at the physical world and things that are made up of atoms, right? Metaphysical could be like, well, if somebody's claiming that there's a soul or consciousness, it's not made of physical stuff, you might say it's metaphysical. Very interesting. Logic, again, this focuses on arguments. Arguments are made of premises, they have a conclusion, there's inference going on, meaning you're using reasoning to get from one point to another. And then epistemology, what's that? Episteme, it's basically a derivative for knowledge, like what things could we know. And then another one, ethics. The Greek word ethos literally means character in Greek. So you have logic, epistemology, metaphysics, ethics. These are hugely important areas, and they're all going to weigh in on each chapter that you're looking at. What can we know? What's out there? What's good, bad, right, or wrong? And is somebody making an argument or not? And if they are making an argument, should I take it seriously? And that's dealing with logic. So let me see here. That's about it. And like I said before, keep in mind that your papers are due in the third week. And I'll close this out by reading this little section. From what little we have covered, however, we can see that a sophisticated philosophical conversation began in India around the same time as in Greece, though it seems to have developed more gradually. So there's dual conversations going on, but it's very philosophical. It's talking about important things. That's about it. If you have any questions, just reach out to me, and I will be opening up the discussion forum for your question over the weekend. And that's it. Hope you have a nice weekend.